Hi, I'm Evelyn.
I'm Naomi.
And I'm Jory.
And this is Pink. We are Pink Snail, and you're listening to 101.9 CFRC Radio.
You're with 101.9 FM CFRC. I'm your host, Paige, and I'm here with...
Pink Snail.
Yay. Okay, let's do some introductions. Names, everybody.
I'm Naomi.
I'm Evelyn.
I'm Jory.
And for those listening, we all have flowers because we have some great decor happening right now. Pink Snail's got the best decor we've had yet. It's just like these beautiful little flowers everywhere. Just like, I don't even know, decorated tints. What is it called when it's a little bit of a flavoring? I don't even know. Sprinkled. Mm. Sprinkled throughout the station today. I mean, what's that? Puntafani Phil? Juxtapani Phil? Oh. The groundhog said that we were going to have an early spring. And I think this is what just happened. We're covered in flowers, so.
There you go.
Juxtapani Phil?
Is that the name of the groundhog?
Puntafani?
Puntafani Phil?
Pextafani? I don't know.
Is that the American one?
Yes.
Okay. Ah, okay, right.
Yes.
Because, well, but in Ontario, we got the Wyarton Willie.
Yes, we do.
Because my mom lives in Wyarton.
Yes. Oh. Has she seen Wyarton Willie in the
She's
flesh?
Related to Wyarton Willie.
Sure. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I'm part groundhog.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I don't know what to say right now. I'm with a, like...
It's best
I'm
not to
famous.
Think about it.
Yeah, I got to treat you like everybody else.
That's
just
got to so
treat
hairy.
You like everybody else.
Because I'm actually 12.
Oh, right.
It's all the milk.
All the milk. Yeah. Okay, so before we start talking a little bit about the band, I want to say as I was watching you guys play today, it was, you guys have a sense of love with your music that I haven't seen, like, so far in the station. And I was listening to your, I had listened to your songs, and I was like, this is cool, experimental, awesome. But then seeing it in person, I was just like, wow. There's, like, a love that you guys have in your band, in the way that you look at each other, that I was just like, this is awesome to look at. This is amazing. So for anyone listening, go check out the live, like go check out Pink Snail live. Do it. Because it was just like a full other, it was like a full other vibe. And I just want you to know that. Like I was just, like I was actually taken aback. I was like, wow, like the smiles on your faces, like it was just love. Hmm. Music, love. And we don't get that. We get music here, but the love is... not as much. So I just want to say that before we start with our interview. It was a little bit deep, but I wanted to let you know because I was just taken aback.
You know what I've discovered with these two? I'm through being cool. I'm ready to fucking cry in front of people.
Yeah.
I'm ready to just let my little jumpy heart go out. Yeah.
Just get loose. Just get deep.
Too old to be cool.
Yeah. So now that we got my little emotional bit out of the way, I do want to, I mean, for the listeners, this is a bit of an introductory interview. So what's the backstory behind Pink Snail? How did it all come together? How did it all come about?
So Pink Snail is, hi, I'm Evelyn. I'm the songwriter and the facilitator. Saying band leader is weird because I feel like we all kind of jump in where we feel like it makes sense. I definitely facilitate a lot of the stuff. I write the music. And so it was a songwriting project of mine. I work as an accompanist in a bunch of other bands. So this is really the thing that I get to kind of like experiment with songwriting and arrangement. And then, yeah, like my friends, my great friend, Jory and Naomi have been learning the parts and, helping bring it together and adjusting the parts where needed. So really for me, Pink Snail is like, yeah, it's a songwriting experiment, but it's also becoming this container where I can like get friends in to kind of like find a way to put their sound into it. And yeah, I'm really excited to have Naomi and Jory with me. Part of the instigation was Jory learned my songs without telling me. He had demos of mine and he calls me up one day and he's like, and I'm living in Hamilton, Ontario still, not in Montreal yet. And he's like, hey buddy, I learned your songs. So are you coming down to rehearse or what? Yeah, since then we've just been trying to like get out on the, now that we've worked out a lot of the music and we've been getting other people, there's other people here that aren't with us that have also been learning the music. So I'm hoping that we can just keep the train going and meet new folks. And yeah, I don't know.
Wow. I love that. So what drove you to just learn the songs? You were like, this is awesome. I love it. I want to be part of this.
I love the music. That was it. What happened? I think I broke down outside of...
Yeah, your car broke down.
Yeah, my car broke down like Evan and I have known each other since 2012.
2012. When the world ended.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah.
The friendship brewed over the it's over, so I guess we gotta be friends.
Yeah.
About it.
Yeah.
Everyone was stressed.
But yeah, no, we met at 2012. I was touring with an old band of mine, and we played a show together at the Casbah in Hamilton.
We're going to play again in a month.
Yeah,
in a month. Yeah. In a week, in a day, in a couple of months.
But yeah, we played, our old bands played a show together years ago, and then we always kept in touch throughout the years, and then, what was this, 2018 maybe?
Must have been.
I broke down outside of Hamilton. I was driving my ex's truck, which was like a 19.
First mistake.
Yeah, that's a whole
red flag
story I'm having to get into. But
the fact that they had to say 19 means they did not give you a good truck. Like, it was 19, and then you're like, wow, they wanted me to break down.
70 something, yeah.
Rest in peace.
It was a cool truck. It was this small red Toyota. But anyways, it died, and I called up Evan. I was like, "Hey, can I come crash at your place?" And like, we hadn't seen each other
not.
In probably a couple of years, I guess, yeah. At that point. And then, yeah, we were just hanging out, and Ev was showing me like, "Oh, this is all the stuff I've been working on," and they had tons of demos already done, and I was like, "This is so cool!" And we jammed at your place a bit too.
A little bit. Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
I remember that? Did some song trades.
Totally, yeah.
Did some years too.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, and we figured out the drums for triple.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, and then so I was like, "Send me those demos, please," and they did. And then I just learned them. Yeah, and then called them up and was like, "I learned all your songs. You should come visit." And then they did. You took a train or a bus and train or something out to Montreal. Bus. We spent a weekend together, and then
lockdown
happened.
Yeah,
on the Sunday. Yeah.
Wow, got right in there.
Yeah,
got the friendship right in there before
before
the whole lockdown. And how did that affect your playing? Did you play more? Did you play less together?
Oh, we couldn't do anything then. So now it was like, for me, it was like, okay, the seed's planted and like, we want to do this. So now we just got to get through this thing. And then on and off, you know, sometimes I'd be like, maybe it's crazy to even think of that because we didn't know what was going to happen. But it was always in the back of my head. It was like, okay, at some point though, it'd be sweet to do this because the rehearsal was so fun. Like, it wasn't like we gotta like slow this down and do. It was like he had worked it out so well that I was like, oh my god, okay, yeah, like this is a thing. I should probably just move to Montreal. And I had some other friends.
That's what you gotta do.
I know, right? And I had some other friends who were bugging me to try it out too. And Hamilton, I love Hamilton. I cut my teeth in Hamilton. I got to play with a lot of cool people. I have a lot of good mentors there that really helped me sort my stuff out. But yeah, it felt like a good invitation to be like, okay, time to switch some stuff up. But yeah, how the lockdown affected it was like, it just meant that we knew we wouldn't be able to do it right away. So we had to kind of, for me, it was like, I had to be creative about how I was going to plan to do it. And yeah, now here we are.
And here we are. Here we are. We're going to play a couple songs before we get back into more interviews. So you want to tell me a little bit about the few that you're going to play for this first section of the interview?
Sure. What did we play? We played Rolling in the Isles and we played Fresh Brews. And those are two songs. And some of these songs are on a record I'm planning to release at some point called This Mess Is More Blessed With You In It. Yeah.
Okay. Well, for everybody listening, so excited. This is Pink Snail, 101.9 FM, CFRC. I'm your host, Paige. Enjoy.
Every single day is a gift-free, rough-free sneaky egg. For you to think when you have your shit to bed. I don't need your pep talk or your positivity. I wanna wallow in the pile of this shit I created for myself. I'm
You're with 101.9 CFRC, and I am Paige, your host for Live Sessions. Today I'm here with Pink Snail, and we just heard their two songs. And now we're super excited to talk a little bit more about your touring and the show that you're playing tonight in Kingston for everybody listening. So we just discussed it. So you're playing with No Static at Next Church with Slow Man Tofu. How are we feeling about that? Excited? Really excited?
Definitely.
Super excited.
Have you played with Slow Man Tofu before?
No, but he's been recommended by a lot of people. So I play in a band sometimes with Lucas Hong called Sien. And he recommended David. And we know Arden from Princess Towers, who also recommended David. So we were just like, okay, this is clearly the person to like reach out to and say hello to. And No Static, Michael has been putting on a lot of really interesting shows. So we're really excited to work with him. And I've just always loved Kingston. Bands I've played in used to play the Artel, or both versions of that. I don't know if you've ever heard of that. It was a DIY space that was operating for a while. I'm not sure if it's going anymore, but
yeah, I'm not sure. I've only been here for a couple years. So.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Might have not.
Yeah. So Kingston has always seemed to have this little pocket of kind of like weirdo DIY punk stuff. I'm really excited.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Kingston, that's so true. We just get for being not that close to Toronto, we get an interesting scene of music. I think it's probably because of the younger population. Bands tend to like lean over here because when you're in university, you're like more experimental with your taste. And at least for me, that's what I found. I started to really like open up when I got here because you no longer have your parents, you know, looking at every record that you bought.
Yeah, totally.
Wow, that makes me sound like I'm really old. I don't only buy records. I also listen to Spotify, but I'm not plugging Spotify right now. But
records are way cooler.
Records are way fun. Cooler. I've been collecting since I was like 10, so... Are you guys collectors? Do you guys collect at all?
I've slowed down a lot, but I still have a bit of a collection at home. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite? Everyone has a favorite.
Yes, definitely.
Lots of faves.
This was when I was like in high school 100 million years ago, and there was a hoarder who lived down the street from the high school who had recently passed away, and his son was like selling off all of his stuff. And he had, it's actually not a crazy box. It wasn't a huge box, but there's this box of records and we were flipping through it. And like the first thing that caught my eye was a copy of original pressing of The Last Waltz by the band, quadruple LP.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a snag.
It's huge.
That's it's a crazy. Snag.
And I think I paid $10 for it, maybe.
Those are the best
I
ones.
I think it's worth like a few grand, maybe. I don't know. I don't really care about that because I never want to get rid of it.
Yeah, but, it's just for you to listen to.
Yeah, it's special.
Your kid will sell it after you die and make it.
I hope
my kids keep it. Yeah. That record rips.
Yeah, no, it really does.
So good. Yeah. The band's awesome. I mean, yeah, like I couldn't sell something like that. But then people don't know, right? They'll just do it. Mm. So I want to talk a little bit about your touring. Before the show today, we talked a little bit about how you've been to Halifax. I kind of want to narrow in on that and ask, what's your favorite place that you've toured? Is there somewhere that you want to go and tour to?
Favorite
venues?
I've only toured in Canada so far. I would love to tour everywhere else that it makes sense to. We'd really like to hit the States. Like, I feel like a lot of our music draws from... traditions that were happening in the States, so it would feel good to place it there. Touring parts of Europe might be cool. We kind of just have to move at the pace of supports that we have and like the access that we have. So far we've just been kind of like just playing spots that are through our community connections and our relationships with other bands and other event promoters and so that's been really exciting. I don't know if I have a favorite, honestly. Like, they each have their own thing going on. And I really just think it's special to, like, just the types of gigs we've been playing have been a lot of DIY spaces and just seeing what people are up to, trying to, like, get things going where they are and the types of people that access it. Getting to play Radstorm in Halifax was really nice. If people don't know about Radstorm, It's like a venue slash screen printing studio slash rehearsal space in Halifax. And it feels like recently, like, the kids there have decided it's also a youth center now. Like, it's always been all ages, and they've been, but they were saying more and more kids are just, like, going there to hang out and use the kitchen and, like, the library and stuff.
They've got a meal program. They've got a meal program, yeah, too. Yeah. And
they got a meal program.
That's awesome.
All sorts of stuff. It's just, like, community, great DIY space, yeah.
Zine library.
Yeah.
Big collection of
it. Yeah. Studio,
yeah.
Yeah. I love that. That's where, like, the best stuff comes from.
Sure.
Community. I mean, even like talking about how like you guys became part of the band, it's like it was because you loved what was going on, and then it became a community within yourselves. So that's awesome with them, like they're making this community. It starts off as a little thing, expands. I love it. I feel like that's what our station's becoming, CFRC, right now. We started out as, you know, music and sports, and now we have variety shows. We have live sessions today that you're on. I just love that. I love when people are coming together to make music, to talk about music. I mean, that's why we're here, right?
Yeah, for sure. It's an exciting time right now, too, I think, because we were talking about, or I think Rue and I and stuff, but we're talking about it a bit before we started here, but like, it seems like, yeah, it seems like a really exciting time for community radio, especially because, people, like young people like yourselves seem so hungry, you know, for like this and stuff to do. And like I was hanging out with my friend Cam recently, who's the station, recently took the job as station manager for CJLO in Montreal, the Concordia. community radio station, and that's what he was telling me. He was like, I don't get paid a lot and I'm really busy, but he's so energized every day he comes to work, because there's like folks that are just getting into university and stuff, and you know, like I didn't get to experience their last couple years of high school maybe, and you know, because of the lockdowns and stuff, and they're like just hungry for it. And yeah, it seems really cool, and it seems kind of the same a bit in like the scene right now in Canada, on that community level scale. Like a lot of towns that, like smaller cities and towns that were, had a scene back when like we were coming up, we started playing music, you know, and, or we were kind of making the scene happen. It seemed to die off for a little while, and all of a sudden like there's shows happening again in like Brampton. We're gonna play Brampton,
Brantford.
Ontario, Brantford. Jeez, every time, Brantford.
Brantford.
And, totally different places.
I know.
Very near each other.
Seems I like love that scenes London's happening. Having that too. London is getting these big acts coming in. I saw the 1975 there, and I was, and they're like, "We're in London," and we're like, "Everyone's like, yeah," but like not England. We're talking like London, Ontario, which is awesome. I mean, I know you guys know that, but for everyone listening, I'm talking about London, Ontario, and that's crazy because. Yeah, I guess like 5 years ago, you wouldn't really go to London to see something. Like you would, if you want to see a big show, you'd go to Toronto for me because I live in Oshawa. But I do love that you were talking about it, like this new emergence. I think it comes from COVID, and we need something to do, and like we're all hungry to actually be out and talk more about community, be with your community, be with people that love the same thing that you love. And if it's music, it really is funny how much that can affect what's going on here. It's definitely affected the community here at Queens. So we're almost cover time on this part of the interview. You guys can keep me talking all day, but so let's talk a little bit about the songs coming up. So was it three or two that you played in your second set?
We played two. Yeah,
two?
We did Cat and Mouse and Peeling.
Right. Yeah. I really liked Cat and Mouse. Yeah. That one was really good. So what was the feeling behind that? Where did that come from?
That's interesting, because I feel like in one way I sometimes just don't remember, and I feel like it's more of like they all kind of draw from similar things.
Right.
I keep thinking about how would be a good way to answer that question. Cat and Mouse is, I guess for me, it was processing a very intense relationship I had with somebody. So it's around mental health and like abuse and, and I don't know, but sometimes that stuff all trickles into, and then Peeling is like a very euphoric song, but it's also got the sad stuff in it. I don't know. I'm still figuring out how to answer this question, because I feel like for me, writing is like this process I'm engaged in constantly, where I'm just trying to like write stuff down, or, or when someone says like a turn of phrase, like charge you an arm and a leg, I'm like, oh, that's good. That's juicy.
Yeah.
And like that sort of like offhand sort of stuff, the way we speak language casually. And then I think too, I just think a lot about stuff that's going on in my world and yeah, the things my friends are going through, the people that I love are going through, or stuff that I'm going through. And it all just kind of like trickles into one kind of like weird pot that hopefully is danceable sometimes.
Oh, so danceable. I was in there like, yeah, okay. I see the vision. Cool. I see the vision. Okay, so you're listening to 101.9 FM CFRC. We're with Pink Snail, and this is about to be Cat, Mouse, and Peeling.
It's red.
You're with 101.9 FM CFRC. I'm your host, Paige, and this is your live sessions for today. We were here with Pink Snail, and we've just been chatting about everything. We've been chatting about COVID, we've been chatting about community, we've been chatting about your music, just everything, everything. All right, so I wanted to talk a little bit. So we just listened to Peeling and Cat and Mouse, opposite order. I mixed that up. So tonight you're having a show, and it's been described as bombastic chorale math punk. So how close would you say that comes to the description that you would make for your for this band, for Pink Snail?
That was the closest one I could come up with. I feel like there's a lot of stuff, and it's always a funny question to be like, what's your band like? Yeah. And then it's always cliche to be like, well, it's too complex. Like, you know? So
yeah.
It's like at some point you've got to be like, what is this? How do I make it short and sweet? Like,
right.
It's bombastic because we're loud. We just play really loud. Jory plays loud. I play loud. You're playing loud. You're pumping it through an amp. So it's loud. It's bombastic. It can be shocking if you're not used to loud music. It's chorale because there's harmonies. There's a lot of three-part harmonies, two-part harmonies. We love harmony. And then it's math. I put math punk because there's kind of like odd time signature stuff.
It
can be very syncopated, but we're not trying to be proggy. Like, it's not like we're trying to be like Dream Theater or something. It's really to serve the song and to serve the prosody of the lyrics most of the time. And we're drawing from a lot of different traditions under the punk kind of umbrella. And like punk as like a communal tradition as opposed to a genre.
I think that description really, after listening, that is the best description that I, honestly, the best description I've ever heard hosting. Like,
okay.
If
you have a better one, please let us know.
Awesomeness. Yeah.
Because most people are just like, loud.
So, too, for everybody who wants to listen, I was just mentioning that you do it independently. You have a website. So,
sure.
Everyone that wants to listen. So, do we want to plug the website?
Sure.
Do we want to talk about why you decided to go that route instead of, you know, leaning towards the more, you know, Spotify or Apple Music?
So all of the Pink Snail music so far is on Bandcamp. So it's pinksnail.bandcamp.com, or some of it is on YouTube through a few of various different things. On Instagram, it's a Pink Snail. So at a Pink Snail. Yeah, I don't know. I guess, like, again, it's this thing of, like, moving with the resources that I have available and moving with the things that have been working for me so far. And then also the things that I have a relationship with. So Spotify is a funny conversation because I feel like any sort of industry, there's always this kind of, like, weird underlying, like, oh, of course they're doing some weird crap with that, like the murder robots with Daniel Ek. It's like, oh, cool. Like, that's why they're fighting Marvin Gaye for his songwriting estate. Like, awesome. But, like, I still think maybe at some point there'll be stuff on Spotify. Like, it's not something that I'm, like, trying. There's no real way to, like, boycott stuff like that in a way that will. So I think I'm just, right now, it's just Bandcamp because it's easier to manage. Like, the admin, there's so many different things for admin in my life where I have all these kind of, like, independent projects I'm trying to do. So it just becomes, like, the more you start to stack on, the more you have to be like, oh, do I have, like, a system for this to actually deal with this, or I'm just like going willy-nilly right now. So Bandcamp and YouTube for now has been easy to manage, and as I start to release more of the records that I've recorded or some of the live stuff that we've been doing or about to do, it might make more sense now to start trying to get stuff on streaming sites. The other thing is I just don't really use streaming aside from YouTube. YouTube is probably the thing that I stream on the most. So part of it is that too. It's just like the relationship that I have with the app right now. So I'm not against having it up there. I just literally haven't gone through, made a system for it yet. And
for
it hasn't
sure.
been on my mind cause I don't use it. I use Bandcamp a lot. Love Bandcamp. Although stuff's changing with that too. So it's like, you know, I get the thing where we want to be critical of Spotify also. I think sometimes people aren't as critical about it. But also at the same time, it's like, you know, there's all sorts of stuff we do where there's always this other weird thing that we just have to deal with.
Well, so as a listener, it was exceptionally easy to like get on and see, like, and listen to all your stuff. Like, it was it was very, I mean, I at first looked up on Spotify, I was like, oh, it wasn't there. Looked up, yeah, just found your band. It was easy, really easy. So for everybody listening, we'll link it in the show notes, and then everyone can give it a listen. Because I really had fun with it. I was like, I haven't used Bandcamp before. I thought it was a cool platform to, I started going down the rabbit hole. It was really fun for anyone that's kind of bored with their Spotify or Apple Music selection. There was just a whole bunch of stuff in there that I didn't get to experience before.
Bandcamp so much. Bandcamp is like, excuse my voice, dear listeners. I'm a little croaky today. Yeah, Bandcamp is my favorite thing. It's so good. It's great for independent artists. They don't have a lot of the larger artists, obviously, but yeah, recently they've been like acquired by like Epic Games, a larger company. And so there are a lot of people, and there have been like, there's a union trying to form and some stuff going Bandcamp against United. That. Bandcamp United, yeah. Go Bandcamp United. So I'm all for that. I'm hoping it works out. If it, yeah, because otherwise our music fucking economy is pretty bleak. This, though, things like this are very heartening as well. Yeah.
Yeah, it's warming. We discussed that.
You bet. Yeah.
So warming. Well, I mean, this comes kind of to the time that we have to leave and say goodbye, but I had a great time having you guys on.
Yeah.
And I appreciate you so much for coming in, because I know that you have a very busy schedule with your touring dates. So I appreciate you thinking of us and coming here today to talk a little bit about Pink Snail and your music.
Oh my God, thank you so much.
Thanks for having us.
All of you guys. Yeah.
The whole staff.
It's a great experience for us. Yeah.
Truly.
All right. Well, guys, we're going to say goodbye. And what's our last three songs, two songs that we played?
So we play a song called The Call. And then the last song is Politically Charged Pop Punk Song.
All right. You guys heard it. We're going to listen to it. Check out Bandcamp. Listen to Pink Snail. We are with 101.9 FM CFRC. I'm your live host, Paige, and thank you again for coming.
Better than this. All the fun and the violence suppressed.